Welcome to part whatever this is of the Electra Amsterdam chain guard renovation. Right, I've got some masking on. I've done a little bit more prep on some of the parts that I'd missed, and of course it escalated. Sadly, the little bit of rust that went under the pinstripes here, and the pinstripes couldn't be saved, so I've just had to go underneath. That'll be painted, and I may be able to touch that in with something. If not, well, the chain guard pinstriping will end early before the word Amsterdam. I've even had to go very carefully around here, very very close in there, cutting away the masking to make sure that I don't get unpainted areas creeping into the Amster bit. I did contemplate masking it off and just leaving it labelled as a turd, but there we are. It is made by Trek after all. Now, we're just about ready to get some primer on. Now, some of you will probably be mentioning stuff called rust converter. I do often use rust converters on jobs like this, which I just paint onto the rust there and it will convert them, because it's rust converter. The parameter by which I decide whether to use rust converter or not is a tried and tested one. It's called if I have some. So, not having rust converter, it's going to get zinc primer. The inside of this I'm not going to do in the white finish. I'm going to use car wheel paint. It's really sticky paint, very strong adhesion. Obviously it's meant for car wheels, so it's roughy tufty, outdoor environment, keep the rust at bay type paint. So the inside is going to get that. Having white next to a chain is a ridiculous idea, so I'm going to excuse the queue of carpet shampooing machines which are awaiting my attention. I have to swap motors, the motor on that one's burnt out. So for the inside that's okay. It's been wire brushed, it's been sanded, as good as. As you see, the outside is prepped considerably better. So now I need to get these hung up and start some paint. Right, it's a lovely balmy evening, so we're going to paint outside. It's very still, as you can see. The wind chimes are not annoying us tonight, and we happen to have an old iron table which is awaiting repainting, so ideal. And we have the primer, the white gloss. It's the domestic white gloss, because this is just, it's just your standard white, appliance white, and car wheel paint for the insides. Now, a word about temperatures and paint. I'm sure everybody knows that paint dries quicker the warmer the temperature, and I have heard of people warming the metal up, heating the metal up, so that when the paint hits it, it's nice and dry. Well, I'm afraid that's the wrong thing to do. What I do, particularly if it's if the temperature is at all on the low side, take the paint, put it into a pan of warm water, not quite cup of tea warm, but over a little over body temperature is fine. Leave it in there to heat up. Obviously, pressurized container. Do not put it into hot water. Do not put it anywhere near any direct heat whatsoever. That's why I said water. Again, the water a little bit more than body temperature. 40-50 degrees is fine. And then that'll just heat the paint up. When you warm the paint gently like that, it enables the paint to flow smoother. It flows smoother through the nozzle, and it flows smoother when it lands on the surface. It'll just spread out that little bit better. If you were to warm the surface, what that does, when the paint hits the surface, it's hitting something hot and it dries almost instantly. And it dries too quickly, and you get the crazing, crackling or it just dries very powdery and it doesn't adhere, it doesn't have time to bond molecularly with the surface. So leave the surface at room temperature and just warm, not heat, the paint slightly, and that'll give you better results. Now, regarding spraying, a little bit of technique. I see a lot of people doing this when they spray. Don't do that. It has to be a constant distance from the tin, from the nozzle to the surface. And another thing that needs to be constant is the angle. Don't be doing this. See what's happening there as your hand's moving, you're turning the nozzle, so you'll get spray coming down at that angle, then that angle, then that angle. It wants to be constantly that angle, so you pan like a camera panning up and down the piece. So just imagine that your hand is on a gantry with a camera attached, and you're doing a sweep like a scanner, if you like, up and down the piece. So the paint stream is vertical and constant distance. Now, triggering at the end of the stroke, which is like that, you stop the spray at the end of the stroke. That's a good idea. It's not necessarily, oh dear, on small pieces, because you'll just go over the edge and your passes will be constant. It's become a habit to people who spray cars. And you spray a lot. If you're on a big piece, you see, if you come to the end of your stroke and back without letting off the stroke, without triggering, you have a fraction of a second when it's stopped there, and you get little pools at the end. So do try and get into that habit. But now there's an example of how I'm moving my hand. That's how I'm going to spray. Just imagine you're scanning the surface, and we'll go around. And this particular item, I want to do the inside, but not the outside. So I'm going to come to the inside of here, not over the top, because then the paint will go over the edge. I'm going to keep to the inside of the ridge, and I'm going to follow that round on the inside to make sure I get a good depth of paint down the inside of here and none over the edge. It's fine to actually paint this top surface, that's great if that gets a good covering. But then when I flip it over to do the right, this will all still be white, and I won't be mixing paints. Paints aren't all compatible with each other. It's another point to take into consideration when you're using rust-proof primers. If I was to slap a load of zinc primer on here from a brush, it might not be compatible with the paint that I'm spraying on top. Ditto that rust converter. And a little bit of my masking's just come off there. You see what I had to do for this pinstripe? I ended up cutting the masking very, very thin to cover the pinstripe. That's not a pinstripe, that's masking tape, that. Right, let's get started. Because this table needs painting anyway, I don't mind about it. I should probably lift the items up to paint them, particularly when we come to the outside. But initially, let's get a coat of primer on. I don't know whether I'm going to be able to film this. I'll try, but I can't guarantee anything. This is what I mean about triggering at the end of the stroke. So the can is still moving as you lift your finger off the trigger. Thin coats, that was a little bit thick. I'm doing something very weird here. I'm not watching when I'm painting. I'm watching the screen of the phone. And I'm actually painting through the screen of the phone. It is most disorientating. So I'm going to put the phone down now and get on and get some more coats of primer. That's enough for a first coat. And then keep going back and adding coats and adding coats. Then you don't get pooling and running. Another thing, if you put too much paint on at once, some of your edges will start to pickle. See there? And that's a badly prepared edge. If that was on the outside, I'd be stopping now and going back and repairing that. It's on the inside and it's getting this thick gloopy stuff over the top, so I'm going to let that be. Right, see you at the other side.